Welcome to the Board of Education Budget Work Session. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV 7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and/or pagers and hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good morning and welcome to our Board of Education of Queen Anne's County Budget Work Session, January 18th, 2017. May I have a motion to approve the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Having a motion and second, any questions or comments? Hearing none, I call for the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. And now we will have our first presentation by Mr. Mark Farley.
Good morning, members of the board. Thank you for the opportunity. This is an ongoing effort on behalf of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools to align our compensation and collective bargaining processes with the needs. Do you want me to go up there?
Okay, please. I'll be able to go through the slots.
Pardon me. Anyway, to align our compensation and collective bargaining processes with the strategic needs of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools. More specifically, to help us address the needs to improve the achievement gap, improve equity, quality, and diversity, improve curriculum management, school readiness, early college pathways, compensation is equitable from a market perspective, and to address capital requests. All of this really requires that we articulate our expectations of jobs, we align those expectations with comparable jobs out in the marketplace so that it's an apples to apples comparison. We've begun doing that for support positions, looking side by side with our neighboring counties and what they pay for the same job, adding to those job descriptions the competencies that are necessary to be successful and the performance outcomes we hope to see. So we begin this process with a compensation philosophy, which would say that our compensation is fair and competitive. We include our neighboring counties, and we look at those very specifically in a cooperative effort with the collective bargaining agents that represent those units, and in a fair and equitable way. We integrate those understandings then into our collective bargaining process. We look at support positions where they're consistent between counties so that we can then create a hierarchy of jobs and know that our scales reflect the realities of the marketplace. And we then move forward with clarification and job descriptions and then into performance evaluation process. I've provided a draft compensation philosophy, which I've shared with the union and gotten some feedback from them. And I thank Mr. Pippo and Ms. Fields for their input. I say it's a collective approach because truthfully, it's not something we have the legal right to act unilaterally on. We want to do it together, and we want everyone who's represented by those units to feel fairly treated. But we only have so much pie to share. So we have to approach that process openly and transparently with an eye toward getting the best people we need to serve our students and keeping them, which is a separate matter. So we've talked a little bit about the collective bargaining process.
We are always going to have sort of unusual positions that don't cover perhaps a great match in other counties, and so we want to try to stick to those jobs that are fairly consistent, and that will allow us a very open and transparent process. But some jobs, maybe which aren't represented, so for instance, substitute teachers. We know they currently make $10 an hour, and the minimum wage as of July 1st is moving to $9.25 an hour. These changes will always create pressures on our compensation process, and this all requires that we get out ahead of it, that we have a longer-term budget planning process, that we have a longer-term collective bargaining strategy, that we have a communication process that keeps all this out front. The market data is available. The unions have other market data they'd like to rely on. But what we do is when we have a job that's pretty consistent between different jurisdictions, we simply create an average, and we include the ones we're competing with, which would include Anne Arundel, Talbot, all of our neighbors. Again, we want to look at the compensation at least 2 years out so that we're projecting into the next budget cycle and doing our work in preparation for anybody who may want to see it. You see the underlined word competencies, that's fairly new to our job descriptions, but it's not just the knowledge, skills, and abilities one has, but how they bring impact on the job. What do you achieve? In other words, you may have a bachelor's degree, or you may have an associate's degree, and you may have 3 years of successful experience, but you have to be able to demonstrate that you interact positively with students and support the instructional goals of the classroom. So those would be examples of competencies versus knowledge, skills, and abilities. This also helps us to create an employment brand that we can put out and use words that resonate with the people who tend to stay here. Our hope is that we appeal to all people, but that in the end that we're able to recruit and retain people who are diverse in the way they represent our employment and mirrors the student population, which is some feedback we've got. Oops. Well, anyway, in conclusion, we need your help to stay on track. We only have so much pie. We want to make it effective, and we want to get ahead of it in our communication and planning.
Thank you.
Are there any questions? Comments?
Thank you all so much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Farley.
All right, thank you, Mr. Farley. Next, we will continue with our budget workshop with our interim superintendent, Gregory Paluski, and our chief financial officer, Ms. Robin. She's here.
Well, thank you again. So we really want to just continue to dig into the budget and looking at actuals as we did at our last budget workshop in December. You also should have in front of you our FY18 budget cost analysis chart, where areas that we're looking at for cost effectiveness improvement, and that will also serve as a framework, as a guide, as we go into picking up where we left off. I believe we left off in instruction. I'll turn it over here to Robin in a second. And then just to continue in the dialogue so that you're able to see the last 5 years of expenditures as we begin to build the FY18. Then at some point today, if we could get there, we'll see how far we get, but it's really to start having a collaborative conversation with the board around where you see priorities, areas that you'd like for us to focus on as we begin to build a budget and present that to you next month, which is coming very, very quickly. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Ms. Robin Landgraf, our chief financial officer, to pick up where we left off on our expenditure review.
Okay. Last time I handed out several sheets of paper. We're going to go back to the blue sheets and these are our expenditures. We left off on page 3, about 3/4 of the way down the page. Does everybody have a copy?
No, I don't. Thank you.
Sure.
Anybody else need one? Okay. We had finished going through instructional salaries. That's where we ended. So we'll pick up with contracted services there on the bottom, about three quarters of the way down the page, contracted services on page 3 of 10. Okay. The first item there is consultants. And essentially what that is, we actually added money to the budget in the current fiscal year for that because we were having our athletic trainers as part of this. And $60,000, we have $78,000 budgeted, and $60,000 of that is for the athletic trainers. And that gets us trainers on the field 5 days a week for this all three seasons. That's right. And then the other $18,000, we have a contract with Success for All for Graysonville Elementary School, which is part of that. And then the rest of it is used for PD, bringing in trainers to train our teachers and our supervisors.
Yes,
right.
The computer programs, that one, train the trainers.
Well, it depends on what the program would be, whether it would be the trainer's model or whether we would actually be training the individual teachers. Just depend on what the PD was for. And something like
Success for All, which is at Graysonville, which has a consultant that will come periodically, and they'll provide one-on-one, well, they'll provide professional development to the teachers, but then what they'll also do is they'll do a walkthrough then with the principal and give feedback to the teachers on how to implement the program. And so that's just, you know, one example. The Campbell Joneses that have been doing work with us on cultural proficiency would be another example of some using some outside consultants to provide that training.
So it's all PD, that whole 18,000.
But only for Graysonville, am I correct?
No.
No.
Part of it's for that Success for All program at Graysonville, and then the rest of it would be used system-wide.
Why Graysonville? Because I didn't know about this on our own.
Probably.
No,
they
shouldn't
do.
No.
Why? I'm sorry.
I live with Utah. Why Graysonville has Success for All and nobody else does.
I'm sorry, what was that? Because I didn't hear you.
Yeah, I think
I was just referring to Janet on your question.
Years ago, we had two schools who were struggling academically, Sutler's Elementary School and Graysonville Elementary School. And we spent an entire year looking at research-based programs that we could bring into those schools. And at that time, Success for All was selected by Graysonville and brought great success, and they've been using it ever since. But it does, it's expensive, but it is for your lower performing student schools.
And
which
why
at
didn't Sutlersville do it?
They selected another program.
Oh, gotcha. Are they still using the other program?
They are not using that program. It did not work as well for them as Success for All did. And part of that was because they did not have the building consultants who came in to continuously monitor the program and continuously to support it. So
that's something we could look into.
Well, I was going to say, is that school performing better now?
Yes, they are.
They are. That's true.
Even without
their trend has been on the upswing, even with the transition to the new assessment.
So maybe we should go back and look at that?
Take a look at it. And one of the things that we're doing for them this year, which we really will incorporate into their budget for next year, is the same type of professional development, but with the materials that we have. So we'll pay for the consultant to come in. It's that job-embedded professional development that's ongoing, where everyone is trained in the same strategies, where we're trained to monitor the data, and we think we'll probably be able to fix it that way.
Okay.
So, but we'll start this year with some of our Title I funds.
But to that is one of the things that the audit had kind of brought up, which is what we're doing now, is really the analysis of all the programs that we're using and whether we get in a big piece here that we're looking at is also the intervention piece. And we're trying to figure out what are all the reading interventions that we have, how much are they, do they cost, what type of students are in there, and are we meeting with success to possibly maybe collapse some things. We've already found some things that we're not using that we're going to collapse and readjust those funding towards.
So what are we paying that, what, how, out of that 18,000, what goes directly to Graysonville Elementary School?
I'm going to say off the top of my head, probably at least half of it. Okay. Goes to Graysonville.
Okay.
And actually, what Mr. Paluski was just referring to is a great segue into the next line item.
Okay.
Which is license agreements.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay.
We've been doing a pretty extensive evaluation of what programs we have, what interventions we have, what
okay.
license agreements we need to pay. I anticipate that this line item will increase quite a bit because we've bought it now that we have one-to-one laptops in most of our schools. The licenses, the initial cost of getting those
right.
Licenses and the software for those was a capital expenditure, but now we have an ongoing annual cost
okay.
that we're going
okay.
to have to.
Okay.
And I think just to put a plug into that, I think that's why this is important for us as a school system to do a five-year projected budget, because to Robin's point, Agile Mind would be a good example. When we purchase that with capital, but it's the outlier years to continue to keep
exactly.
running the program at $90,000 a year as an example,
right. Right.
that if we can kind of forecast and project that. The other thing I'll make a segue back into, and that was about the interventions. Next month and the month after, we'll give you an update on the Innovation Center and the work that they're doing. So Team 5, which is monitoring progress and performance, that's the work that they're doing.
Okay.
So
okay.
they'll present to you the interventions, how much it's cost, how are they working,
right.
and some recommendations. So I just want to make that connection back to
that's good.
The Innovation Center and how all this is tied
right.
together.
Okay, that's great.
Okay, so that gets us through contracted services. You can see the last item under contracted services was other, and those were years where we had contracted for the assistant superintendent position. And you can see there's only a few years that we have money allocated for that. Then that brings us to the last item, or the last section there on page 3 of 10, which is supplies and materials. The first item under that is textbooks. Our county has essentially taken textbooks out of our operating budget and requested that, you know, anytime that we have a series that we're purchasing, any new textbooks that we're buying, that we buy them as capital items. So that shows up over in our capital budget, and they have given us money over the last several years to buy textbooks on the capital budget.
But we're still lacking there. From what I understand, we're still lacking in, not every student has a textbook. We haven't had new textbooks in some subjects for a long, long time. They can't take their books home because they have to be used by every student to take that class. So if they take one home and don't bring it back, that's going to leave a shortage for the next class that comes in. Are we looking at that at all?
We are.
Okay. I mean, I know textbooks are...
Sure.
You know, not as popular
sure.
as they used to be, but...
No, and you bring up a really good point. I'll go back to how this ties right into the curriculum audit. That's really in standard two. We look at the specificity of the curriculum, and where we've uncovered there is areas that we don't have curriculum. So one of the things that Ms. Pauls and her team are doing is they're doing a five-year projection of what we call a curriculum development cycle. So they're looking at, in all the content areas in the next 5 years, hey, this curriculum hasn't been updated, or doesn't have an updated text. So we can kind of get an idea of which courses that we need to prioritize and begin writing and aligning those resources and purchasing those resources as we continue to move forward. So that's a very important strategic planning piece when it comes to determining the dollar amount what's needed. The other side of this is the blendedness between a hard physical text as well as maybe a tech book where the resources is online. And I think what we're learning and what the research is telling us is, and Ms. Pauls and I have been out for the past month doing our school visits, you're seeing a lot of blended instruction where not 100% of it is online. You're seeing kids that have a physical text in their book, and I think what we're hearing from teachers and resources, that's how the best approach to teach is in a blended environment where sometimes it's on a computer, sometimes it's in a hard text. So we're getting a very big picture of what those needs are in the 5 year, as it relates certainly to the capital request and where those needs are in each individual course.
Great. Okay. On down to the next section is materials of instruction. And basically what we do is we, once we get the September 30th enrollment, we project what the next year's enrollment is going to be, and then we allocate resources to the schools on a per pupil basis. And so $51.20 per pupil at the elementary school level, up to $44.80 per pupil on a secondary level. And that's how they are allocated their materials of instruction. Most of the money in that category is allocated to the schools. There's very little that we hold here centrally, and they spend that money. The Xerox cost, this is the money for the Xerox machines at the school level. These would be, they have, you know, copiers throughout their buildings, and this would be the money that would be allocated to pay for those copiers. And then guidance supplies, we have very little money. This is generally allocated from support services and Mr. Engel's department out to the schools on an as-needed basis. Do you have any questions on any of that so far?
Why is that increased by 50, what is it, $2,500 almost?
It's been $3,600 for a very long time, and they just generally don't spend what
they're allocated. So your five-year average is what they're spending of it?
Yes. The five-year average is the actual five-year expenditures, yes. So that is something that could be reduced.
And I think that, to your point, Ms. George, that's one of the things that we've been looking at, is looking at a five-year average versus, you know, the budgeted cost, and looking at possibly being able to reduce that in areas where the spending allocation isn't just, it's not justified.
I think that's how we've been doing it. We've come forward with budgets every year. That's how we, right, what we've been looking at, as I recall.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The next area, media supplies. Again, that's the same way. That's also allocated to the schools based on a per pupil basis. They get, every school across the system gets $11.25 per pupil for media supplies.
Can I ask a question on that?
Sure.
Is that for the media specialist to use to purchase books and items for the media itself?
Yes.
Or the school uses that money? I mean, is that budgeted in for the specialist to say, okay, well, I need books, I need paper, or I need whatever?
Should be a part of their collection at the school.
Okay.
Not doled up.
Right. Okay.
That's a good question.
But it's not earmarked, right? I mean,
it is earmarked for the media centers.
For the media centers.
Some media centers require some of the AV supplies to be purchased through the media center.
Oh my
also.
God! What's
so
AV supplies?
Audio visual,
the bulbs for
projectors,
okay, those kinds of things. Some of that they require that to be part of the media supplies.
But does that come from the central office evaluation, or is it when the principals come forward with their budgets? This is what you pare it down to.
For their
their budget requests, yeah. How do you decide if you go with what the principal says, or average of what all the principals say, or how does that work?
Well, we started out probably 10 years ago. We used to give them $25 per pupil for the media center. And over the years, as we've, you know, had to cut into different areas of the budget, we're down to giving them $11.25 per pupil. So it's just a straight allocation on a pupil basis.
But to your point, Captain Kelly, with the principals do come in with requests of bulbs, and as we know that that's a expensive item at $355 as an example. And so that's something I think that we're trying to get a handle on centrally of the needs when it relates to those items. When it relates to the collections, we have to report every year to MSDE on our collections within our library media centers, and they go through a cycle ensuring that they're relevant collections. And I think some of that is allocated to for that as well.
Yes.
Okay. It's a combination of what they need versus what we're able to give them, basically.
Yeah, and I think that's, I mean, to your point, that, I think that's something that we're trying to get a better handle on, too, is not only the material needs, but the role of the media specialist, because they also serve a big key role when it comes to if Chromebooks are down, and they're the ones that, that mm-hmm. put together the ticket item. So they have a huge, with this explosion of technology, now they've become kind of the hub center of the school as it relates to, you know, working with ComTech as well. So I think that's something that we're trying to get a better handle on each school's needs as it relates to the technology side and their role in that.
The next item is professional library and in-service supplies. These kind of go hand in hand. The professional library would be things that we would, you know, resources that we would purchase to have available here at the central office for either our specialists or our supervisors to use as a resource for, you know, coming up with the PD, those types of things. And then the in-service supplies would be actually the supplies that will be needed as they hold workshops with the teaching staff.
We're going to reduce those pretty drastically, it looks like, from the five-year average, mm-hmm. at least for the in-service supplies, correct?
Well, that is currently what is budgeted, is $3,600. And you can see, on average, we've been spending almost $12,000 on that. So that will be an area that we would need to look at increasing in our budget request.
Where in here, if anywhere, does that little small amount of money that we give every teacher to purchase supplies at the beginning of the year fall? I know
$100.
Some schools give the teacher all of it that's allocated. Some schools, the principal doles out what they think is appropriate and perhaps keeps the difference for something the principal feels the school needs. Where in here is that stipend or whatever
really?
You call it?
That would be under grid. Materials of instruction.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it would depend. There is something in the teacher's contract that says they have up to $75 that they can go out and spend and get reimbursed for.
Right.
For materials of instruction.
Right.
That's part of that.
Well,
there's also at each of the different schools, and they do it a little differently school by school.
I know that.
Some principals say you have $150 to spend in your classroom, Mrs. Smith, and she goes out and she can order things from Office Depot or
causing
wherever.
A little contention, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
We have teachers who say, why don't I get as much as X school does? And I'm wondering, is that somewhere where we need to get involved and make it more across the board? There's some real misunderstandings and some animosity about it. My principal didn't give me that.
Well, that's what I was getting ready to say.
I heard it a lot.
If we're given the principals $100 per teacher, why aren't the teachers getting that $100?
Because the principals are keeping some of they think it's school stipend.
Yeah, no, we're not giving the principals $100 per teacher. In their contract, it says they can request reimbursement up to $75. Some teachers do it, some teachers don't. And what they do is they go out, they spend their own money, they bring in receipts, they fill out a form, and they get reimbursed their $75. That comes from us centrally. That's not part of the school allocation.
Right, I think we're talking about two different things.
Yes, two different things.
Okay.
But there is still some animosity in the doling out at the principal level per school.
Yes,
because this teacher talks to that teacher, and that teacher got more at that school than this teacher got here, and everybody wants to know why.
Because their budgets are different.
And it's different.
And that's a very important part. Right. That's a part I think they're not catching.
It's not a very small school at Church Hill.
Yes.
It's based on my enrollment, so my teachers would not get as much.
Right. There's different needs.
There's our key schools. And that, I think, is what needs to be disseminated to the teachers who might have that question.
You've got a high school, it's 1,200 versus 300 kids.
Absolutely.
It would be much different.
Perfect. Perfect. I was not clear about that either. So.
Okay. So I think we do need to look at the workshop supplies area as to possibly adding more money to that line item in the budget. The next line item is license agreements. Now the difference between this license agreement and the one we just talked about a minute ago, was the instructional part. That was the license agreements for having technology in the hands of students. This license agreement is more the infrastructure part. This is your internet content filtering, the Microsoft Office licensing fee, Novell, those kinds of things. More of the system, the hardware piece, and the control of the hardware.
Are those also being looked at as to which ones we are getting the most money?
Absolutely. Like, we'll give you an example of Performance Matters, which is our platform, which is what Team 5 is working on, and looking at how much the cost is of that. What are some of the issues that we're having with the company as it relates to the service with that? So the answer to that question is yes. We're looking at all those platforms and trying to, you know, long-term vision is really consolidation into a one-stop shop learning management system, because right now, whether you're a teacher or whether you're an employee, you got to go open and close all these different platforms that, if we can consolidate them, maybe do some cost savings, but make it, at the end of the day, really more effective and efficient for the employee and the primarily our first priority is the teacher. Because we have many different things. Whether it's the Performance Matters, the curriculum, they're in five different places, which really can get frustrating for a teacher. So if we can go to one single log on and one single platform, in time will make it a lot more efficient of resources that they can pull.
So then that basically finishes up supplies and materials under instruction.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
The Chromebooks, now we have everyone having them, and they were at the capital purchase. Now, replacement of Chromebooks, because, I mean, they are older. I mean, they're getting beat up. Replacement of the cases and all. Where is that included? Because that's going to be an operating cost, you know, annual operating cost, right?
It's a little bit of capital. There's a capital piece in there as well. As a matter of fact, Mr. Pender and I were meeting yesterday with our folks in ComTech of looking at where we are at the end of that cycle of what the commissioners have allocated in our capital funds for equipment. Now we're looking at really the next 5 years and trying to some kind of cost estimate that when it becomes time to refresh, which is a discussion we had yesterday, which is we've purchased all of our equipment. Could we save money in the long term if we lease that equipment? And with companies that are, the responsibility of fixing it is on them, not on us, because of many of the eight techs that we have, some of those folks full time, we're seeing a huge spike in middle school right now of the lag time. You know, we have 80 to 100 Chromebooks that are out right now that are not in the hands of students. So we're trying to decrease that time and be able to put that device in the hands of a child. So to your point, yes, and I think that's one of the things that we'd like to come back to you as a board with is sometime is that longer, bigger term picture of, you know, it's with anything when you implement, you think this is what you're going to spend it on, and then it has to be adjusted.
Well, I thought the original purchase included a little bit of repair for a while, maybe for the initial warranty or something.
The high school ones, to the best of my knowledge, that was included for the Dell, not for the Chromebooks.
We didn't have enough people on staff a couple of years ago to repair all these things, right?
That's exactly right. So now that when we've increased that, last year we restructured some things, we added another position. There's a total of 9, including Josh, Mr. Combs, that's in that office. Yeah. And that's exactly what we were meeting over yesterday, Captain Kelly. And that's what I was trying to get a handle on is how much time are they spending just fixing Chromebooks? And we have 2 people right now. They just live in middle schools. Mm-hmm. That's all they do. But when we talked about mileage, one of the things that we're finding is, I mean, we spend almost about $20,000 a year just for these gentlemen to travel around the district. So the conversation we were having is, could we regionalize that where they're not traveling as much to save some funds, but more regionally can service the schools in a general geographic area? Because it's not just Chromebooks, and then you get into, there's the high school piece of the Dells, and then you've got employee. You know, then you got the tickets, and this is kind of where it goes back to the media center folks. So
interactive boards.
The we haven't even got into that of the classroom, of just trying to maintain the functionality of the classroom. But I do believe we can be a little bit more effective and efficient with how we're looking at the best service delivery model is what we have servicing our schools to the best of our ability.
That's where your five-year plan was really handy.
Yes, because it's not only, you know, that's the, there's the infrastructure piece of this that, you know, the technology's great, but teachers will get frustrated if it doesn't work.
Right.
And then we were in a classroom, Ms. Pauls and I were in a classroom the other day, it wasn't working. And so you could see the teacher being frustrated with having, you always should have a backup plan, but it was, you know, it was actually good to observe, this is real world teaching of mm-hmm. when it doesn't work.
And the kids, the frustration for the kids when it's, sure. when it's not working.
And that's that infrastructure piece that we continue to build upon, but it's the, you know, the infrastructure to make it work, and then right. it's the actual device itself. Mm-hmm. And there's not a school system doesn't move in this direction that, you know, this is, even in county government, you know, when you listen to them, this is a growing area in any organization, in any business of this increase in technology and how can we try to do a better job forecasting to the best of our ability, see what it's going to cost, but yeah. also maybe save some with a refresh program that we think is on part of the contract and maybe reduces somebody's, you know, sole ability just to be able to.
I kind of look at it as like the first generation. All right, we instituted, here's everything.
We know.
Now the second generation right. is, how are we maintaining it? And are we doing right. a decent job, as the superintendent says, of supplementing the instructional aspect of it? Because if it's down, it's down. I mean,
right.
so I think, you know, we have the items now. What are we doing to maintain that? And what is the five-year plan along with the cost associated with that? So,
yeah. The next area is other charges. And we start with travel. And then I really want you to look at those two first line items together, the travel and the homebound travel. This is travel for teachers to go from school to school, particularly Kent Island High School, where you have people who are going from Kent Island High School to the annex on a daily basis. And this would be anything else where they would travel to a meeting out of county or actually even within county that we would be reimbursing them mileage. The travel homebound, this is for teachers where we have students who are either being home or on home hospital where we have to go into the homes and teach those children. So you can see the home hospital line item is severely under budget, and then the regular travel line item is well within the budget. So between the two of them, I think there's ample funds. We just need to move it from one line item to the other. Meetings and conferences, this would be a line item. And most of this had been used in the past for water, you know, meals at meetings, those kinds of things. When we bring teachers in after school, we give them a little snack, water, whatever. We have eliminated that this year, so that this number is down dramatically, and I think that we'll be well within that budget line item this year. Professional improvement, something that we don't do any longer. This was when we used to have in our contracts that we would reimburse our staff, our teaching staff, $300 for professional, belonging to some professional association, and we don't do that any longer, so that's been taken out.
That was the union dues part?
Yes, yep. We okay. took that out.
Right.
That was for subscriptions, was that what that was for? If a professional affiliation?
It was a professional affiliation, and most of them used it to pay their dues to belong to the teachers association.
Okay.
So we included that, it was a negotiated item. We increased the salary scales that year and then took this out of the budget. Teacher of the Year, this is money that basically is allocated for whoever we name as Teacher of the Year. There's a lot of things that they're expected to attend during the course of the year, and we reimburse them for that. They're also given a car from Hertrick, but we need to make sure that the car is insured, so we have to pay the insurance on that. And
depending on who the person is and their driving record, that number can vary dramatically.
Wow. And their age. And their,
yeah, exactly.
So funny, the reality.
Think about
exactly.
That.
Exactly. The next line item there is tuition regular. I'm not sure how many of you were on the board a couple years ago when they passed the dual enrollment law where we have to start paying part of the tuition for students who are dually enrolled. And
Senate Bill 740.
Right.
I didn't know that.
Yes, we do have
we
to
do.
Pay. Just kidding. For the first four classes that a student is enrolled, unless they're free and reduced, and then we would have to pay 100% of those students.
We're projecting a lot more, like double the amount for sanction. We projected that for 17, we were going to have double the amount that they had in the 5-year average. Actually, it's only 5,000 more than the 2016.
Right. Because the 5-year average includes 2 years that had zeros in them,
okay,
it kind of distorts that number a little bit. Okay. But we have $15,000 on that line item, which has covered every year that we've been so far. And we are encouraging more students to try to get
Absolutely.
Into that program.
That's a choice you made.
The next section, we have band and athletics, and you can see each year we budget $15,000 for the band, and this is to purchase equipment at either the high school, middle school, or elementary school level. A lot of it's used for larger pieces of equipment, timpani drums, those kinds of things. And then athletics, both of the high schools are allocated the same amount of money, $48,750 for athletics, but then they are also allowed any gate receipts that they collect during the course of the year, any family passes that they sell for, you know, admittance into any games or anything, all of that goes back into their athletic budgets, and they're able to spend those funds also.
That go into their athletic budgets through our school system or into their athletic boosters?
No, into through the school system.
Excellent.
Through the school system.
And just so you know, once they get to playoffs, like specifically football, that all of that gate revenue goes back to MPSSAA.
Yep.
So,
yep.
You know, that's
right.
Not...
Yep.
Yeah, basketball and all that's a little bit different. Once
right.
You get to like the regionals, then that's when it kicks in. But football, the whole caboodle goes to MPSSAA.
I only asked that because I didn't remember it ever coming through us boosters. So I
no,
wanted to make sure
it doesn't come through the boosters. It comes
yeah.
back through us.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. And most of that money, I mean, the cost, and I've given the board breakdowns on this before, and we can certainly do it again, but just the cost of officials, helmets being reconditioned every year, those kinds of things. It's really pretty expensive to run up.
Absolutely.
Athletic.
Now, I know we never had the athletic trainers before, but was any type of that service included in that prior to us hiring our own athletic trainer?
No.
No, there's nothing, anything that would have been included in that.
Because the stipend for the athletic trainers would have come up under salaries back when we were talking about extra duty. And that's where the trainers were paid from before.
Okay.
And we have a miscellaneous account, $5,000. And this is really, every year we do a luncheon for our seniors who are in the Honor Society. We have certain students that will make All Shore Band or All Shore Chorus or, you know, have something special that a student has accomplished that we're able to maybe support a little bit. There's not a lot of money here. As you can see, in certain years, back in
I was just gonna say,
fiscal point. Year 14, I'm not sure what was going
there was
on.
There big something going on that year.
And then there's a small amount of money that has been spent for dues and subscriptions, and we have nothing budgeted for that, but I think it's insignificant enough we don't really need to. Which brings us down to furniture, fixtures, and equipment. We have no money currently allocated for this. Again, this was a line item that we moved over to the capital budget as much as we could. However, we still have ongoing expenses. A cafeteria table breaks, you know, somebody needs a new chair for their desk, you know, those kinds of things. We're gonna have to replace those. That's not something. So this is one line item that we may need to look at putting some money on this.
With the renovation of Sellersville Middle School and Stevensville, we were able to use items from those schools, but we have since depleted all of that in our warehouse pretty much.
Yeah. Anytime we have a renovation or a new building, any of the still usable furniture or equipment is transported to the warehouse, and then it's, you know, sent out to the other schools from there on an as-needed basis.
It's my understanding that we did a major clean-out last year or early this year of excessive furniture that we had in that warehouse. Is that correct?
We put some things on public surplus. A lot of items that get brought to the warehouse are no longer Bash. Usable,
mm-hmm.
And we don't throw them into the dumpster. Mm-hmm. Depending on the price of metal, if we can, you know, does it cost more for us to strip it down and recycle it, or, you know, do we just have to get rid of it? But yeah.
I mean, I certainly understand if it's outlived its usefulness.
Yeah.
I just know a particular teacher had completely done a new seating arrangement in her classroom, and they kind of thought that she might be able to get some items from the warehouse, none of which were any longer available because whatever we had in the past was pretty much disintegrated anyway. That's how it ended up there. Now, her principal worked very, very closely with her and was able to get her these items. And it's a pretty innovative idea, and I think we're going to see more teachers asked to do something like that. And I'd like to see that we have the resources for them to do so, because it's been very successful.
Sure. Sounds good.
Okay. Moving forward, that brings us down to transfers. And this is transfers to other Maryland LEAs. And essentially what this is, if a student in our county is placed in another county, foster care by the courts, if they're taken out of the home here in Queen Anne's County and placed somewhere else, we have to pay that other county to educate that child. So depending on how many of those situations we have a year, you can see this number has varied, you know, the low being 46,000 and the high being 73. It's varied from year to year. So we currently have $50,000 on that line item. And depending, I think we've just finished filling out the information as to how many, what these are considered out-of-county living students, how many of those that we have, and I haven't seen those numbers yet as to whether that 50 is going to be able to support that this year or not.
And in turn, that would be the same thing for us if we are educating another county student.
Yes, and we talked about that a little bit when we were talking about the revenue side of things. We would be able to collect revenue from other counties if we had that same situation.
Not to be confused with our homeless students who we transport back to educate.
Right.
Different.
Yes.
That is correct. Okay, so that brings us to the conclusion of instruction.
So maybe this is a good time. It is 12 o'clock to take a break, mm-hmm. to have lunch, and we'll come back into, are there any questions? This section? Okay. We need to close it out.
I don't think so. We're just taking a break. We'll be back in an hour, I believe.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is there any bad foster care?
Okay.
Thanks, Jeff.
Welcome back to our budget work session. And now we'll continue on with the budget. Robin Langford.
Sorry.
It's okay. So we're going to move on to special education, I believe.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We'll be on page 5 of your blue trend analysis chart.
Okay. So we start with salaries and wages. And essentially what we do is one quarter of the curriculum, the assistant superintendent of curriculum and instruction is charged to special education because they're obviously overseeing that area too. So that's why you see part of that auto allowance, and then the supervisor for the special education is charged in there. When we go down to, there is a part of a secretary, and we changed that. You can see a couple years ago, the budget and the actual has gone down from what the actual was, because we used to have a full-time secretary in special education, and now that person is split between special education and career technology. We have a coordinator position, and this is the person who is working with, it's actually part of a salary, and it's a person working with the infants and toddlers program.
Are this is all the benefits too, right? Associated?
No,
with
this is just salaries.
Only a salary.
Okay. Only salaries. Mm-hmm. Substitute teachers, and then all of our special education teachers.
That substitute teacher one, I mean, clearly budgeted way too low.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 5-year average is
right.
3 times it.
And I think we talked about this a little bit when we were talking about instructional salaries. That was actually purposefully done.
Okay.
Knowing that we were going to have some money that would be generated through attrition and would be able to help fund that those substitute salaries.
But I mean, you can't really rely on attrition, right?
I was going to say.
That's right.
I mean, I think it would be better to have actuals
budgeted
in the budget. Mm-hmm. And then if we do have the attrition,
then we use that.
Then we can use that later.
That could kind of somewhere up.
Yeah. I'd rather see actuals.
Yeah, this is real self-defeating, I think.
Mm-hmm. What'd you say?
Self-defeating.
I think it's just a different philosophy in how it's been budgeted in the past and how we want to look at it in the future. The philosophy before was that rather than taking new money and putting it on a line item for substitutes and using up the new money that you have available, then you would use the attrition money for that, knowing based on trend data that you always had that attrition that would be happening from year to year. So,
right, but if we're going to do a 5-year plan to present to the commissioners, I'd rather do it on actuals than on attrition.
That's exactly right.
Yep.
And that's what we're proposing to the board to do that.
Yeah. Okay.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
And when we talked about with the substitutes that we had been budgeting 3, but we're spending 5,
mm-hmm.
we need to budget 5.
Absolutely.
So that's
right.
The actual.
Right. Absolutely.
And so
mm-hmm.
that we get out of the cycle of banking on attrition money to run our operation.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want to be able to budget appropriately.
Because that looks like that should be like $75,000, yeah. Not $25,000.
And
if you really look at it.
They've been very clear that they love the way we do support some of our programs with leftover funds. But those are never a given. That's not going to be
right.
Set in stone.
And they can
every
know
year.
That we're going to still have those.
They like that we do that and don't come to them for an additional handout.
Right. Right.
But to me, they need to know the real number, especially on a salary item.
Yeah, I agree.
Substitutes aren't salaries, but it's still...
Right.
Planning to... When are we projecting that 5-year plan? Is that this year you're going to put out the 5-year plan, or kind of late to?
Yes, I think it's a great question. I my recommendation would be, Captain Kelly, as soon as we put this budget to bed and present it to the board and we present it to the commissioners, we should start right away
mm-hmm.
with putting together, because that's going to take a little while. So by the fall, we would have a 5-year plan that we could mm-hmm. share with the commissioners, engage in a conversation, so that when we start the next budget,
right.
we'll
right.
have something, at least a rough framework to start
right.
with,
right.
Okay.
To start conversation. So
mm-hmm.
I'm gonna guess we would have it in the next 6 months, 6-7 months. So we'll finish this in February, I would say. We'll start in March.
The next line item there, let's say we're talking about substitutes, so we've got special education teachers, a helping teacher, that's somebody who's in this building, who's an 11-month employee that helps with special education. Speech therapists.
Now we're way over here.
In speech therapy?
Mm-hmm. We have 5-year average.
We have more budgeted, and the reason for that was because we had a couple speech therapists that left that we were not able to replace, and we ended up having to hire contracted services to replace those folks. If we can get a salaried employee, we would prefer that because the contracts are so much higher than a salaried employee, but we've had a little difficulty over the last couple of years being able to do that.
And so it makes sense not to change this at all, to keep that number where it is.
Right, and excellent. Try and continue to excellent. Try to hire those yep. those folks.
Is that a field that's really lacking in a lot of resources for us to go to and fill those types of positions? I've heard other systems say,
it's hard to fill.
Yeah, I mean, I know most of them seem to work in the private sector.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know why, whether the money's better.
Money is always better.
You know, the hours are better, whatever.
How many do we have?
Speech therapists. I am going to say we have 6 on staff.
Okay. Full time?
Full time.
Okay.
And I believe that we have at least another 3 or 4 that we are contracting with.
Okay.
But let me verify those numbers.
Okay. I'm just interested. I, you know.
Right.
It's not one or two. It's a big segment.
Oh, it's a big segment.
And it's got off. It's also a hard segment to fill.
They are covered under the teacher's contract.
Teacher's contract.
Yes.
Okay.
Just as behavioral stuff.
But that is also a, you bring up a very good point as it relates to the budget and it relates to the allocation of staffing. So one of the things you'll see in this next budget is that when you look at ours, it in the budget book it might say, you know, 100 staff members, but one of the things it doesn't say is in which category or how many are special education, like this doesn't say how many of those teachers are special education.
Right.
Doesn't say how many of those are therapists, how many of those. So we'll provide that to you in this next budget. So you actually know the actual number of people that are in that category.
And we're working towards getting that put together. Speech therapists, and then there's an instructor out at Queen Anne's County High School. And then staff specialist, these would also be people who would work here centrally with the special education department. The next group, sign language interpreter, we actually have 2 of them currently. School assistants, we have a number of school assistants across, and we have, there's 2 different line items here. There's one that says school assistants, and then there's one that says assistants. The school assistants are full-time, paid a salary. The assistants are hourly folks. We have a lot of 5-hour.
Because paras.
Paras, paraprofessionals, yes, school assistants. Mm-hmm.
So that's something we're looking at as well. That's a lot of people. That's 58 people, so we're looking at their use of them effectively in how we're providing special education services across the district. I'm not convinced yet, the evidence that I've looked at, that they're being used in the most effective and efficient way.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something in special education.
We added some last year, too. I think we added some.
School assistants. Yeah, I was going to say, I think that's something on a yearly basis, whether they're in our local budget or they're through some of our special education grants, we seem to be adding them on a yearly basis. Yeah. The secretary clerical, this was a position that was added for the infants and toddlers program. And then we talked about assistants. There are hourly 5-hour assistants. Job coach.
Secretary and clerical, it looks like it went up.
Well, they didn't have it
over 4,000 from just 2016. That's what I'm looking at, the 5-year average to the current. Did we add someone or did we just increase all of their salaries?
I would have to go back and look. It could be that we were budgeting and then we're able to hire somebody at a lower salary than what we had budgeted.
Okay.
I would have to go back and look exactly what that was. Then we talked about assistants. Job coach, this is out of Queen Anne's County High School, and this is a person that we hire that travels around with students who are in the life skills class, who are placed in different businesses throughout the community, and the job coach goes out there and works with them. And then we have school assistant substitutes, and then school assistant summer. And summer is something that we've just started doing over the last couple of years, as we've had a couple students who have been in programs through the summer. Last year it was the summer theater program that the student was attending for their extended school year. So I think the substitutes is actually a little high. We could probably look at that to reduce that a little bit. I think the and possibly even the school assistant line item is a little high. And that could be because of attrition where we've hired folks and then we're able to replace them at some, you know, if somebody left, we were able to replace at a lower salary. The next group of salaries, teacher homebound. And we put money in there. These are, again, the home hospital, but these would be specifically special ed students that were in home hospital situation. And then summer teacher, again, we have programs. A lot of the students have IEPs that require them to have extended school year and get services throughout the summer. And this is with the money that would pay for those. Workshop participants, generally that gets charged to PD under the regular instruction. And then other compensation, the only time we would have anything here is where we would be paying somebody out either annual leave or their sick leave according to whatever contract they fell under. And that's pretty much it for special education salaries. Do we have any questions on that? We move to special education contracted services. And the first line item there, it's labeled consultant, which could be really a misnomer. This is where our OT, PTs, the ones that we were speech therapists, the one things that we were just talking about, the related services for special education. And I think that budget line item is pretty close to where it needs to be.
Isn't that run part of, is that part of the consortium that we're
no.
in? That is not.
No, that's separate. Later.
Well, if that is that part line. Of that, then why is it broke down into separate, like the, you're saying that that's like the sign language interpreter, the speech therapist and all, why is there a separate line for it with more money in it?
Well, there's two different pieces.
Okay.
There's up at the top what we were just talking about were salaries. Those are people who are on staff. These are people who are not on staff.
Not on
that
staff.
We're paying a consultant.
Okay. That's what I was trying to.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this is, we end up paying for some of these services. We have to provide them according to students' IEPs. So sometimes we end up having to
contract them.
Okay.
And that generally costs us more money.
Right. I'm sure that.
However, there might be a time where we don't even need it, so that's why we don't hire somebody within the system to do that on a regular basis, because we may not need it as often as
And that's a possibility.
Okay.
A lot of it is we can't find them to hire them.
Right.
That's
yeah. You know.
And then
could we afford them if we could?
What's that?
Could we afford them if we could?
And exactly. Gotcha. Either they've priced themselves
right
out, or we just can't
right
even find them to hire. License agreements. These are licenses for specifically special education, where they would, it's generally programs tracking students, tracking IEPs, helping them process the IEPs and those kinds of things. And then the next line item is legal services. We've been very fortunate over the last couple years that we haven't needed a whole lot in legal services for special education. But I think that trend is changing a little bit. We've had more expense this year than what we've had the past couple of years. So I think leaving 30 in there is good. But if the trend continues as it has this year, that may not be enough on that line item.
Mm-hmm.
That's it for contracted services. We go to supplies and materials. Again, the textbooks are something that we've moved over to our capital account. And materials of instruction, we also give the schools an allocation on a per pupil basis for supply or their materials of instruction. And that's $7.68 per pupil and for the elementary to $6.72 for the secondary.
How much was secondary?
$6.72 per pupil.
Okay.
And that brings us to other charges under special education. And we have travel for the regular, and most of that goes to your speech therapists who are traveling from school to school, or your occupational physical therapists that are traveling school to school, and then we have the homebound travel also.
And on that travel,
mm-hmm,
kind of going back to what we talked about last meeting with the stipends, travel stipends for teachers, this travel would be a documented log where they spend X
yes
number of minutes or miles on the road, and that would be a receipt-driven
yes
allocation, where the stipend for the teachers was just a basic amount of money that
principals
we felt, I mean principals, thank you, comfortable being fairly equal to what they do. Okay, but this is documented.
This is documented on, you know, January 17th, I drove to the Board of Education.
Because I would guess they're traveling everywhere. I mean, they're traveling to each of their clients that are outside of the system. They're not bringing them in.
Right. Generally, this is travel between buildings, because
okay
we don't pay them to commute
okay
to work.
Okay.
So we only pay them once they have gone to their first building, if they have to leave that building and go to
right
another
or
building
to the homebound students.
Yes.
Okay.
And then
okay
the homebound students, right.
Okay.
Professional improvement, we talked about that before. That's gone away. And then meetings and conferences is something that, again, we're not doing this year. And dues and subscriptions is pretty minimal. And we do not have any allocation for that. The next area is furniture, fixtures, and equipment. And we allot $5,000 a year. And depending on who the students are, which students we get, and what their needs are, this can vary dramatically from year to year if we need specialized equipment, especially computer technology equipment for these students. And you can see that's been up and down. And then the last item under special education is transfers. And there's two line items there, and I kind of want to explain the difference between them. The first line item, transfers to other Maryland LEAs, this is the money that we were talking about goes to the Midshore Special Ed Consortium. And the Midshore Special Ed Consortium is housed out of Talbot County, and they hire some very special T-type folks, audiologists, those kinds of things. We don't need to have one on staff, but we do occasionally need some of those services, so we're able to get those services provided through the Mid-Shore Special Ed Consortium. Now, there are folks from the consortium who are assigned to our county and are here on a daily basis, but then they also have some of these more specialized folks that we're able to access through them. And then the second line item there is transferred. It also says transfers to other Maryland LEAs. This is our non-public placement kids. There, we do have a certain number of kids in the county, and I believe the count this year is six, that we are just not able to meet their needs. And so those students are placed in a specialized school, and we are required by law to pay the tuition for them to go to that school.
What one is that? I'm sorry, is this the transfer to other?
The second one. It's the second one.
We increased that up by 100,000 from last year?
Well, actually, we decreased it. It was, at one point in time, it was, well, actually, at one point in time, we spent well over $1 million on that line item.
I know, I'm just looking at fiscal year 2016, it was budget 25. 225, and now 2017, it's 328.
Right, and actually, this year, we're spending more than 328. We're spending over $400,000 this particular year on that.
But is that because we got additional students
We actually have two students that their tuition for their non-public placements are over $100,000 a piece.
And one of them is new to our system. Therefore wouldn't have been budgeted anyway.
Right.
I mean, if you look at the actual for 2012, it's huge. It's huge. But those children have moved on.
Right. So we some might not have replaced them in the
meantime,
the system,
and now this year we got new ones.
Or they, you know, for we've been able to bring them back, some of them. As I was saying, at one point in time, we were well over $1 million on this particular line item. We had, I believe, up to 15 students.
And the state and the federal don't. There's no money in there for schools like us, or for any school. But when there's children that have to go into these private schools, per se, is there funding, extra funding from the state or the federal that come in there?
Yes.
Oh, it is. Okay.
There is some extra funding.
Okay. Okay.
Essentially, the way it works is the state gives us a number, and they call it the 300% number.
Okay.
This year, it's around $24,000.
Okay.
Where we have to pay the first $24,000 of the tuition.
Okay.
Once we reach that magic number, then the state participates. We pay 70% and the state pays 30%.
Okay.
So that's why these numbers, and when we looked at revenue, there was a line item on our revenue side under state revenue that was called non-public placements, and that's where that
revenue comes in.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that is special education. Moves us on to student support services. And under student support services, the first part is the director of CNI, which again, we charge 25% of the salary, or the assistant superintendent of CNI. 25% of the salary is charged there, and then we have a supervisor in that area, both of which get an auto allowance, and those are those first three line items.
So that salary is $144,000? That CNI salary?
Yes. Yes. The next line item, secretary and clerical, they do have a secretary in that department, a full-time secretary. And then we go down to pupil personnel workers. We have two of them in the county. Workshop participants. This is for stipends for the student assistance programs that they have at the two high schools.
That seems a little bit high, mm-hmm. What we budgeted for in 2017.
Yes, that could be reduced a couple thousand dollars, I think. And then resource specialist, This is our home school coordinator, Ms. Ward. And then we did have a behavior specialist at Graysonville that was charged in here that has since been moved to the special education part of the budget. And then again, other compensation that would only be used in a situation where we would be paying out somebody's annual leave or sick leave. That's it on salaries. Consultants, we have nothing budgeted under consultants. We had one year where we had contracted the assistant superintendent position, so you can see where that was. Brings us down to office supplies. There's very little, $4,000 budgeted in office supplies, which is actually more than what they spend, so that's a line item that could be looked at. Travel, this travel is for the PPWs, because they are all over the county. I think each of them have, half the schools in the county, that's the way that they're split up.
PPW? What is that?
Pupil personnel workers.
Okay.
We have two. Subscriptions and dues, there's very little budgeted there. And then meetings and conferences, sometimes they take some of those travel funds so that they're able to attend conferences.
Yeah, but subscriptions and dues is budgeted 50% over what we spent last year.
Yes, that could be reduced. A couple hundred dollars. And then furniture, fixture, and equipment, there's nothing budgeted there. And that is it for student support services. It's a very small category. Which brings us to health services. A nurse assigned to each of our schools, and that's the cost of their salaries. And then we have a line item in there for substitute nurses, because we do bring in substitutes when those folks are out. The only other thing that's budgeted in this cat, well, two other things budgeted. We have medical supplies. We supply all of our health rooms with what we call discretionary meds, where you get Tylenol, some cough drops, some cough medicine, that kind of thing that they're able to distribute to students on an as-needed basis. And also, you know, cold compresses, those kinds of things.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Under the salaries and wages for the nurses and the substitutes, I mean, we're adding almost $80,000. Are they getting ready to get a raise that we don't know about?
They probably got another nurse. Mm-hmm. But that's what I looked at it as, maybe. There's a
Well, one of the things that,
new hire, maybe?
And you'll notice in our cost-benefit analysis chart under human resources, we have nurse staffing. And one of the things is between having a RN, a registered nurse,
right,
and a non-registered nurse is a much higher cost. And so that's what we've looked at, is to say, okay, do they really need to be a registered nurse,
okay,
and have that credential or not? And many of them are not. But that, okay, is a, and Robin would have that number better than I would, about the number of those nurses that are
registered RNs.
They are.
No, we have, I think we still have four that are LPNs, and the rest of them are RNs. And then we have some that actually have BSNs. So, I mean, we've got quite a range in there. But
so it's cheaper to have an RN than it is an LPN.
Well, then maybe it's cheaper to have an
LPN than a that's what I was thinking.
If their function is basically the same,
mm-hmm,
because in a school system, there probably isn't going to be, you know, as in a hospital, and I know this because my mom's an RN, why would there be a pay scale difference? If their job is
the same.
Because their level is different. Just like if we have a teacher with a master's and a teacher without, their scale's different.
They're represented by the support employees unit. Remember that?
I know, but why wouldn't we seek, if LPNs are all doing the same job as the BSN nurse, why wouldn't we seek more LPNs to take those positions?
I think it's important that we take a healthy, broad look at what it is we need in every job.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. But because I just can't see that a nurse that has an LPN in a school system would be doing much different, or if any difference, than a BSN.
Right, but
we've gotten a lot of input from the county, from the I can't remember.
Health department.
Health, from the health department, about, because they provide technical oversight of our nursing function. Uh-huh. But we want to work through what's the most effective way to meet our students' needs within our budget. So
I would just like to see what the difference is, if there is even a difference, of what when we hire an LPN.
Salary-wise.
Not salary-wise, duty-wise, because be, to me, based on a duty at that role.
And it is, because you say, for instance, a school where you have Kent Island Elementary School, and they have the critical need classroom. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot more, the kids are more prone to seizures, things of that nature. If you have kids that are severe diabetics, it varies dependent, you know, because of the level of service.
Do we move, say, an RN to a different school based on the need of the student?
I don't know if that's been done, but I know it's been considered.
Okay.
You know, because I know that.
Because I'm just thinking, if we had a school that's heavily into maybe diabetic seizure patients, mm-hmm. that maybe that would be the school where you'd want the RN.
That's where you want the RN.
And then,
sure,
and
makes
then
sense.
That would make sense for the salary differences.
Right. Yeah. And they do try and take that into account.
Okay.
I don't know how much movement is done, but I know it's taken into account to be able to meet the needs of those kids, because some of those kids have really high levels of seizures.
Sure,
and
sure, I totally get it. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. So they really have the.
We'll look into
our ends.
We'll look into it.
Yeah. Okay, and then the only other line item under health services is a little bit of money for travel, and generally the nurses don't travel from school to school much. This would be if they were sent to a meeting or something outside the county. And that's all there is for health services. The next area of the budget is transportation. And the first line item there we have is director supervisor. And this is actually a combination. This is 20% of Mr. Pinder, and then the supervisor, Miss Margaret Ellen, Miss Kay. Then we have a secretary that's assigned here. Warehouse, this is really your two driver trainers. We have two driver trainers out at the warehouse that train all the drivers for both the county and for all the contractors. And then the dispatcher assistant, that would be also at the warehouse, the person who, you know, controls what buses, schedules all the field trips, those kinds of things.
So we train contractors, drivers, is what you said? Train them on how to drive?
We want all of our drivers to have the same training throughout. We don't want to bring in somebody that, you know, drove for another county. I mean, how do we know that they have the same standards that we have? We have a set of standards. They come in, they meet our standards, then they qualify to drive a bus.
Okay.
That's a good question.
Okay, and then drivers. I believe that we currently have 20 drivers on staff, and then we have additional drivers that drive field trips for, you know, all your athletic trips, your band trips, those kinds of things. Other compensation, we do compensate our drivers who are part of the weather group. When, you know, Sid and Margaret Ellen are up at 4 o'clock in the morning making phone calls around the county, we do compensate those folks for getting up and you know, helping us to evaluate weather conditions.
You forgot to write their paycheck this month, didn't you?
Are we having a lot more? Because it's increased 3 times what we paid last year. Almost 3 times. Will we be having more of those, or is that? We don't know. it varies from year to year. You can see back in 2012,
we were almost at $9,000, and then we dropped down to five, and last year we were almost at six. So the average has been six. That is certainly a line item that we can look at to reduce.
Yeah.
And then field trip drivers. This would be all of the athletic trips, band trips.
Why do we have so much more in?
That's quite a
2016.
That's right.
Do they make the playoffs?
Well, it could all depend.
Well,
part of that, but if you're making the playoffs, you know, one year, sometimes we have to fill in one open event. It ends up being out in Fort Hill, Allegheny County. So, I mean, you're taking.
Right. So that's, I mean, that's directly related to how many trips that we're taking, how many competitions the bands go to, or the chorus, you know, those kinds of things.
I personally think we should add to that one.
Yes, I would agree.
Sports teams in both high schools are doing really good this year, so got a lot of that.
Substitute drivers, we just started keeping track of that the last couple of years, how many substitutes that we're paying to drive. And then school vehicle assistant, this is something that we just started at the end of last year. Some of our buses, our special needs buses, were required to have two adults on the bus. Our philosophy 10 years ago was that we would put two drivers on the bus because some of those routes during the course of the day would exceed, you know, 6-7 hours. So having two drivers on the bus, if one got tired, you had another one there that could take over and whatnot. We're having difficulty finding drivers at this point in time, so we're going back to trying to find just a school assistant or a vehicle assistant, somebody, another adult to be on the bus to help take care of those special needs students. And we've been doing that this year also.
Correct. Almost all the school districts are finding critical shortages in bus drivers and bus assistants. Pretty standard job. And remember, it's a split job. Starts in morning, take a break, go back to work in the afternoon.
Tough to find.
Takes your whole day, even though you're not using your whole
day.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, right.
Robin, do we have, where is it in here for the overtime compensation?
That would be part of this.
That would be part of?
Of where you can see the warehouse drivers, or the warehouse, the driver trainers.
1474?
1474 and 1473, those two line items there.
That also includes overtime.
It would include the overtime for those folks, yes.
And that number has been in the last year?
Well, you can see last year.
Over?
Last year we spent $142,000. We only have $120,000 budgeted this year.
But how much of that is specifically overtime? All of it?
No.
That's what I thought. So what percentage of that, what is that total cost? I thought it was like $25,000 or $30,000 we're paying in overtime.
We are. I don't know the number. Yeah.
Is that right,
my
Sid?
Yeah.
It's about in that ballpark, yeah.
Mostly to your warehouse folks?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
This is overtime for drivers?
Trainers. Yeah.
Driver trainers. The folks that work out the warehouse.
And that's something that that's also on our chart here, I believe. Overtime.
Do you know those folks?
Overtime transportation, which would be the second line item down. Is that correct, Sid?
That's correct.
Yes.
I mean, that's a lot of money in overtime. Tremendous.
Where do you see that? I'm
it's in
on this sheet. Yeah, on this on that sheet. Yeah.
Yep.
Under operations.
Second one down.
And maintenance, it's the second one down.
There,
so that is something.
Overtime and transportation.
Okay, yeah.
So that corresponds to these two items here, but you wouldn't know that
by looking at that
number.
Mm-mm.
Only the fact that it's over budget. It has been pretty consistently. I mean, last year it was $142,000 that we spent for the driver trainers, and the budget for the current year is only $120,000. Last year, for the dispatcher assistant, we spent 56 and we only have 39 budgeted, so both of those line items.
I think that that overtime compensation needs to be a line item.
You may be right.
So that it's not in that, because
yeah, you wouldn't know.
I just
that
wrote in. I just wrote here under warehouse two driver trainers, and the dispatcher assistant, not knowing, because I'm thinking, darn, somebody's making some really good money here, being for training, and but now I know that 25 to 30% of that is overtime compensation. That should be a line item in there.
Separate from.
Because that's deceiving. You know, when you look at that, that's what you think. If it's being explained to me that it's two driver trainers, and then the dispatcher assistant, it looks like we're paying the three of them $160,000. So I personally would like to see that somewhere on a line item, overtime compensation, because I think that that's deceiving to see that.
Well, I think it could go in the same category, just its own
line. It could,
absolutely. We'll just break it out.
Exactly.
We'll see where in the whole
that's
world.
And that's exactly. I mean, I'm not, you know, just put another line in there that says overtime compensation, so and put that percentage point, like you've said, on the other ones, so that we know what that is of those amounts.
Maybe someday in a perfect world we'll have it budgeted and they won't use it.
Yeah. Right.
We didn't have any overtime this year.
Towards substitutes.
Yeah.
They might not like that, but I just think it's deceiving as to.
Yeah, we can make that. We can make that more transparent. Sure.
Yep.
No problem.
And that takes care of salaries for transportation, then moves us on to contracted services. And the first line item there under contracted services is the bus contract.
$300,000 more.
Mm. Right. How long is that contract for?
Two years.
So that is through 2017-2018 school year.
So beginning in this summer, that's one of the things that we'll have to start doing is
contracting out.
Oh yeah, exactly. Start that, because we would like to go into December having that finalized. But this goes back to the 5-year plan. We knew another 2-year contract.
Right.
Or we can see what it's going to look like in the next couple years for each one of these major contracted items.
Right.
And also the way we built that budget this year was that we built it so that any increase in the contract would relate to the CPIU for the Baltimore Metro or the Baltimore Washington area. When I looked at that, it's not out for December yet, but for November, that would be a 1.2% increase at this point in time.
Okay.
I don't know how it will lurk. We said that we would use the one for January.
Right.
So we've still got a couple months before we know exactly what that number is going to look like.
Okay.
But that is associated to that. Consultants. Most of the money out of consultants is money that we're currently spending to have a contract for the Angel Tracks camera systems. I was trying to remember what the name of the camera system.
I couldn't remember it from the meeting either. Somebody asked me.
Yeah, Angel Tracks. Bus inspections, we're required by law to have 3 bus inspections each year. And this is money that we pay for mechanics to come out to our, usually it's a parking lot in different places in the county, where they all the bus contractors bring their buses to have them inspected. Safety training, again, we're required by law to provide safety training to all of our bus drivers, including any substitutes, once a year. I think it's 6 hours of safety training they have to have every year. Computer maintenance. We have the TransFinder computer system that we use to do computer routing of the buses, and that's what the cost to maintain that is. You can see in fiscal year 2015, we did an enhancement to the system, and that's why that year was so expensive. medical fees. All of our bus drivers and contractors are required to have a DOT physical every year. We pay for the DOT physical for all of our employees. Drug testing, we're also required by law to randomly drug test all of our bus drivers. This is not just our county drivers, but this is also all of the contractors. And then bus repairs, cost has actually gone down over the five-year trend data, and that's because the county has been generous and allowed us to replace several of our new buses. So we've quite a few new buses on our fleet. And then field trips, this would be any time where one of our drivers did not drive the field trip, that we actually contracted it out. Some of this is for taking the swim team to their facility to have practice, taking the golf team to the golf course, those kinds of things. And that is essentially it for contracted services for transportation. You have any questions on any of that? That moves us into supplies and materials under transportation. The first line item there is, and the majority of the money is allocated for bus operations. We purchase all of our fuel through the county depot, and a majority of this money is what we're paying them for our fuel purchases. But again, it would be, you know, tires, oil, windshield washer fluid, you know, any of those types of things. And then we have some money for printing, and that would be printing the transportation handbook, and then office supplies, and that would be for both here and out at the warehouse.
Why could we not combine that and get rid of, if it's, we spent $503, do we do that? Do we do the handbook every year?
Yes, done every year. To be done, revised with all the different COMAR regulations.
But if we did it in-house, I mean, wouldn't it be cheaper to do it? Or do we do it in-house?
We do it in-house, yes.
Okay, we do it in-house.
That's the cost that for us, for the paper and all that. But yeah, Ronnie does it in-house.
The ink, paper.
Okay, and then that brings us to other charges under transportation. The largest line item there being the insurance for those vehicles, and we do hold insurance on not just the county buses but also the contracted buses.
Any idea how many that is?
How many buses?
Or how many vehicles we do that in?
On the buses? 72, 20, probably about around 92,
around 92.
Contractor and county-owned buses.
So we provide the only insurance that our contracted buses carry?
Through May.
Yep. Okay.
We provide liability insurance for the contracted buses.
Okay.
They provide collision and...
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So no, it's not the only insurance the contractors have. And then we have meetings and conferences and travel. The transportation department generally has, I want to say, quarterly meetings.
Yes.
State meetings, where all of the transportation supervisors within the state get together. Auto expense, this would be the expense for essentially the supervisor of transportation's vehicle. And this would be the fuel plus any tires, gas, or tires, oil, that kind of thing. And then we have subscriptions, which is very minimal. Which brings us to furnitures and fixtures and equipment. And essentially we have two line items there, one for replacement of buses, one for equipment. Replacement of buses is really replacing engines. Any large problems like that we would encounter during the course of a year. As you can see, a couple years ago, in fiscal year 15, we had several of them. and then equipment. We're responsible to maintain the crossing arm on the front of the bus and the strobe light. And so that would be any time we would have to replace them. And we do that not just for our buses, but for all the contractor buses also. So that brings us to the end of transportation. Move on to operations. Operations, again, we have the director, and this would be 40% of the director's salary. We have lead custodians in each of our buildings, and then additional custodians, and we have one building service foreman. Down to the next section, part of our staff at the warehouse used to be charged to operations. It's no longer charged that way. We do have a supervisor. This would be the ComTech supervisor, and then the computer technicians. And we have increased that staff, and that's why you see that budget line item increasing.
And how many do we have?
ComTech staff?
Nine. Including the supervisor.
And then the last line item there under salaries is other compensation. Again, this would be any annual leave or sick leave pay. We move on to contracted services, repairs to equipment. And this line item actually is one that we can look at to maybe reduce a little bit. But this would be any repairs to, say, kilns or band equipment or any of those kinds of items that we may need to do. Timekeeping maintenance, this is the cost for maintaining our ADP timekeeping system. The next line item, computer maintenance finance, this is the cost of maintaining the, we use software as a service for our SunGuard, which is our HR payroll and general ledger software. Computer maintenance ComTech, this is money that's allocated to the ComTech department to maintain any of their equipment. And then maintenance contracts would be contracts that we have maintaining elevators, fire alarm systems, those kinds of things.
And some of those, Robin, are yearly, multi-year?
Most of those are yearly, I believe.
Most of them are yearly, fewer quarterly, like sprinkler system checks.
But those are all negotiated?
Yes. Okay. And that brings us down to supplies and materials. The first item there is custodial.
Thank you.
Custodial supplies. And this is a line item we need to look to increase. You can see our five-year trend data, our average that we've been spending. It's been about $250,000, and we only have $200,000 on that line item. And data processing supplies, these would be supplies purchased by the ComTech department in order to maintain equipment. And then we move down to other charges, travel. A majority of this travel is for our ComTech department. We were talking about them moving from building to building, being dispatched out to the schools. And then we have our insurance. This is basically property insurance, buildings, vehicles. This would be our fleet vehicles. This would be the vehicles in our maintenance fleet and Mr. Pinder, the car, that kind of thing, and boiler insurance. And then we move on to utilities. Heat is the first line item there under utilities. And these are very hard to budget for. You can see we have gone from $683,000 in fiscal year 2012 down to a low of $427,000 last year. So fuel costs have been very low recently. So line item, I would be a little leery of looking at it too hard.
Be affected by weather too.
Exactly. If we have a really bitter cold winter.
Or vortex and it's all out of
whack. Yeah, so.
But any.
Days when we used to close county buildings.
Right. But you can see we're budgeted right about what our average has been, and I think that's where we need to stay.
Yep.
Any savings there, Robin, at the end of the year, let's say we budget it for, but we don't have a harsh winter, that goes into fourth quarter transfer money? What I would call fourth quarter transfer, end of year?
Yes. When we see what the heating season looks like, when we get through the heating season, we can ask for a transfer to transfer that money to the instructional part of the budget, the instructional category, and then we could, at that point, spend it on instructional needs.
Because I think that's a very important thing. We talk about fourth quarter transfer money is one of the things that we've been doing is we'll take fourth quarter transfer money, we'll use that for items that should have been budgeted, and so we want to kind of get out of that cycle and try to budget so that we've got, you know, some extra funds, we can put that towards some innovation or kind of wish list items that maybe didn't make the budget.
Not shortfalls.
Next line item is electricity. Again, the budget is pretty close to the five-year average. It's actually a little bit less than what the prior year expenditures were, actually the prior 2 years. And as we get more buildings that are geothermal, this cost actually goes up because we're not spending as much on the heating side of things, but we have many more air exchangers in the building. So the electricity piece of it's going up. Then you have communications. And again, last year, the five-year average, we're pretty close within, $8,000 of where we were, of what we have budgeted. Water and sewer, we're right on track. We've actually just received an increase in the town of Centerville. We received an increase at the end of last year for the town of Sudlersville. So looking at where we are in the current year, I think what we have budgeted is the correct number. And then we go down to equipment. We do have a little bit of equipment. It seems that we're constantly replacing floor machines, vacuum cleaners, burnishers, those kinds of things. Seems to be a constant need. And that's it for operations. We move on into maintenance. We again have the director, the other 40% of Mr. Pender's salary, a coordinator, coordinator for support services, a secretary here at the central office. And then you can see that last year we added in construction manager, and this really should be facilities manager. And we used to charge that position completely off to construction projects that we had going on because we had a lot of construction projects for many, many years. We don't have that anymore. We're in very good shape with most of our facilities at this point. So we need to start bringing that facility planner into the operating budget as opposed to charging that off to the construction projects. There is no auto allowance or other compensation.
So that $70,000 is now part of the facilitator's salary?
Yes.
And that is number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's 6 on the FY budget cost benefit analysis sheet under operations and maintenance. You'll see it says facility planner 0.5 to operations.
Okay. And then we have our maintenance staff. And you have, what, seven?
Yes.
Seven maintenance men and one foreman. Now, half of one of those folks is actually charged off to the food service operations because they spend their time working on the refrigeration and in the cafeterias.
When is this, remind me again when the Sodexo contract is up? It's a 5-year contract.
It's a 5-year contract.
I think it still has three or four years left.
I was going to say, I'm thinking we're just in the second year.
Okay.
We opened it up to other bidders.
And that's it for salaries under maintenance. And then we have contracted services, building repairs. These would be, you know, anything with a building
chillers,
essentially a lot of it is the HVAC, things that we're not, our staff is not able to do that we have to contract out. Refuse removal, we actually bid that with the county.
Wow, that's awfully high.
Refuse removal?
Well, I know that each year things get a little bit, but you know, you start out in 2012 at 75. And in 2016, we're now at $27,000 more. I mean, that's only a 4-year span.
I guess it correlates
maybe
to
we
tipping
should,
fees.
The tipping.
We do put it out the bid, and we go along with the
we
county.
We do put that out.
We can, yeah, so we get a larger volume of what we're dealing
right,
with.
Right, right.
And I know they open up the...
We put it out to bid yearly?
No, we do about a 3-year
bid. Okay.
It's usually, it's a 2-year
that's about as often as I change my trash services about every 3 years lately because of that very reason.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, that's like astronomical.
And the more trash services that come in, the more competitive everybody becomes. Right. I mean, I kept the same service for 12 or 15 years, but it got so overpriced because I hadn't moved anything, I hadn't changed anything. They weren't going to offer me a lower rate.
No, that's right. Right. Yeah.
And we've had a lot of influx of new businesses in that category.
Right.
So every 3 years.
Yeah. So basically, the way we rate that contract is we bid it out. It's a 2-year bid initially with a 2-year extension on it. So we can, each year for 2 years, we could extend it. So it actually could end up being a 4-year contract for whoever did it.
And right now, are we serviced with a local Queen Anne's County company or did the bid go to another county?
No, we have an Allied.
Out of
we were waste management,
but, you know,
and now we're Allied.
Yeah.
But they all have the opportunity to bid on it, yes, ma'am.
Yeah. We struggle.
We're only
in this
doing
county.
It every 4 years.
We struggle getting.
It could be up to 4 years. It's 2 years, and then if we're not satisfied with that, then we go back out the bid. You know, if we are satisfied with it, we do the 4-year contract with it.
Okay.
The 2 plus the 2.
Yeah. Just seems like, you know, you go in 4-year period and it goes up $27,000. That's a lot of money.
A lot of money.
That is a lot of money in a 4-year period.
And actually, I think between the biggest jump is between 14 and 15, and that was when it was rebid because the tipping fees at the facilities have gone up so much.
Right. Right.
It's a direct correlation to that. The next line item there is pest control, and we're required to do integrated pest management.
Department of Agriculture.
Right. And then if we have any other issues, then we have to bring in pest control for that. Environmental testing, this is essentially water testing, quality testing, anything that would need to be done in that realm. Upkeep of grounds. This has been a consistent number over the last 5 years anyway. And this is what we pay to Department of Parks and Rec to do our grass cutting, keep up our, maintain our athletic fields, all of that. And then maintenance contracts.
Elevators, PA systems.
Thank you. I was drawing a blank on what was that. Okay, supplies and materials, repairs to buildings. This is money that we would, for our maintenance men to buy supplies in order to repair whatever equipment that they would need. Vehicle operations, this would be the cost of the gas, the tires, the oil for running those vehicles.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then those are the only two line items that are budgeted. Travel, we have very little travel in the maintenance department because we do have vehicles for them. And auto expenses would be any repairs to any of their vehicles. We were able to purchase one new truck this year, and we're getting ready to purchase a second one. Our maintenance vehicles are pretty old and have a lot of miles on them.
300 some thousand.
SMS has one of those, don't they?
Yeah. Yes. When they leave here, they go out to the school and we get paid.
Or you 100. Have to climb in one door because the other door don't open.
We get our money's worth.
Yes, we do. Okay. And then that brings us down to furniture and equipment. And we had left the line item there for vehicle replacement. And that's because we had purchased a vehicle 3 or 4 years ago on a lease. So we had that lease payment that we were paying out. Any questions on maintenance?
Yeah.
Okay, and that brings us down to the last category in our budget, which is fixed charges. Essentially, a majority of this area of the budget is really fringe benefits for the employees. And most of this, with the exception of a few line items, is driven either by the government with percentage, you know, payroll taxes, percents, or by the collective bargaining agreement. So the first item there is retirement, which I think most of you are aware that the state of Maryland has started moving the retirement costs back to the county government or to the counties. So you can see, you know, back in fiscal year 12, we were only at $600,000 and we're now at $2.3 million. 2.9 is what we have budgeted for the current fiscal year. Social Security, that's directly related to what we have in payroll. Course reimbursements, this is an item that's in the contracts, the negotiated contracts where we pay them if they're, you know, working towards a master's degree or whatever, then we would pay them X number of dollars per semester hour. As you can see, we've not been using that up to what it's budgeted, so that might be a line item that we look at.
But a lot of that is because a lot of our teachers have already aspired to that level, right? We have about 75% of our teachers that are at that level now, so we're not going to have as many applying to use it as maybe we did 5 years ago.
I'm not sure about the numbers.
It's hard to anticipate, Sharon, because we may have more who pursue administrative certifications or things like that.
And they still have continuing education credits they have to get for their certification.
And for renewal.
So even though they have a master's, they still might have to get six credits to keep their certification.
Do we pay for the whole thing, or we pay for a percentage of it? What is it?
There's a dollar figure that's established in the contract.
Oh, in the contract.
And depending on where they go to school.
Right.
And what the cost is.
It's not quite half.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I was wondering about.
It's almost half, but not quite.
Okay.
Is that less than it was 10 years ago? I thought it was a little bit more back in...
It very well could have been.
Okay.
We'll have to check.
Okay.
Do you want me to check?
Probably percentage-wise, it probably is less than what it was 10 years ago.
But it was closer to about 75.
Because the number in the contract really hasn't changed a whole lot. Uh-huh. But I think the tuition at schools has changed.
Go.
So okay. I think probably over the years, our percentage has probably increased.
Okay.
Okay, and then the next line item there is health insurance. As you know, we're part of the Eastern Shore Health Alliance, the consortium, and we purchase our health insurance through the consortium with five other counties. And essentially what that does is, you know, quality, the number of people, the quantity of scale, that we're able to purchase our insurance for less. The last 2 years, we've had very minimal increases in their cost of our health insurance.
But we negotiate that with the health insurance through
the health insurance puts part of the negotiated agreement.
Because we have
as well as retiree health insurance is covered.
Because we have over what 250 employees that we pay 100% of their health insurance.
Only 250
that we pay 100%.
Why is that?
Because that's the way it's negotiated. Depending on what kind of coverage they elect to have, if they elect an individual EPO coverage, then we pay 100% of it. If they elect an individual PPO coverage, then we only pay 90% of it. So depending on, and if they elect a family coverage under the EPO plan, we pay 90%. But a family coverage under the PPO plan, we only pay 70%. So it depends on what type of coverage they elect, how much of it we cover.
The percentage of coverage steers people and incents them to choose something that's good for them but less expensive for us. So the net out is positive. But it, like everything else, we have to look at it.
I was going to say, I mean, can that be changed where everybody's on the same?
It's a negotiated item with the union.
The question is, what are we willing to do in exchange when we modify?
When we looked at it, right. just those employees, if those employees alone paid $51 a month, we could save nearly $200,000.
Wow.
Yeah. Not many places paid.
I was just going to say, I'm not sure of any organization today that pays 100%.
Didn't we use that in the past as a recruiting tool?
Yes. For the individual employee.
Right, not the family, not the spouse, not the kids. Because I had it for years, just me, and they bring it.
And that's attractive to our recruiting process, of course.
Wow.
Sometimes I took jobs just for the benefits, not for the salary.
Something we should look at.
Yeah. We should look at that. Yeah, we should.
Okay, and then moving on, insurance, liability insurance. This is through, we're part of the MABE group insurance pool for our liability insurance. Workers' compensation, again, through the MABE group insurance pool. But we have percentages based on the category that, whether it's professional or a driver, they have different rates based on that. Term insurance, that's part of our negotiated contract. We pay for our employees to have term insurance starting at $42,000 a year and going up to $50,000 for our teachers group and support employee group. Unemployment insurance, this varies from year to year. We're actually on what is called a reimbursement. We pay dollar for dollar whatever is claimed against us. Most companies, or some companies, smaller companies, they would pay a percentage of whatever their payroll is into a fund, into Maryland's unemployment fund, and then each year that would be reevaluated. We don't have to do that because we're a government employer. And so they just bill us anytime that we have employees that claim unemployment. We have to pay dollar for dollar what is paid to those employees. And you can see that has varied quite dramatically from $127,000 down to $56,000.
Yeah.
And then retiree insurance, in our negotiated contracts, we have a sliding scale. Depending on numbers of years of service, how much of insurance we will cover for retirees once they retire. Legal trust, we're part of the MABE legal trust group. Scholarship tuition, this is something that we used to fund. This was called our Grow Your Own program. And we had put money aside, and each year we were able to give scholarships to students. And then we had students that didn't complete the program, paid the money back, and now we have money sitting in a liability account, about $40,000, that people have paid back over the years that didn't complete the program. So we're looking at giving some of those scholarships again to use the money that was set aside.
So we don't, is that the program where if they take the money that they have to come back here to teach?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
And we don't have anyone currently doing that?
If we do, then they're being paid out of that liability account where we have collected the money back over the years.
Not to be confused with the HOPE scholarship, where they also have the same agreement that they will come back and teach in Maryland for every year they receive that. This is significant just to our system giving scholarship dollars to our graduates.
That's correct.
And we used to, then we've gone through a period of time where we haven't been, but money's come back. Now we're looking to maybe offer it again for a year or two.
Right.
Without any burden on us, just simply using up our funds we've set aside.
Exactly.
And ultimately the question
is, I wonder
how
my daughter missed out on that.
How can we get the best teachers with the resources we have?
That's right.
So it's not just about the program, it's about operating effectively.
And keeping our own, our students that graduate, stay here and work.
Yeah,
or come back here and work.
That in here is
while simultaneously improving our diversity.
Perfect.
And
keep them in our county. That's,
that whole life cycle.
That's right.
Don't
born,
raised,
live. You sound like he's interested.
Here.
Hopefully.
Maybe, I don't know. Just wondering, it's not a good saving. It might be something we increase. But were you going to look into
that? I don't think that we put that on our chart as scholarship tuition.
No.
We did put tuition under finance and budget, but I think we were thinking that was student.
That was actually a revenue stream on whether we needed to decrease that line item or out of county tuition coming into the county.
Did you want to look at, are you looking into that?
Yeah, we'll look into scholarship tuition. That will be more specific. That tuition was out of county.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Increase it.
And then the rest of those items, background checks, blood bank, and insurance, football, those are all things that we are no longer funding. Background checks, maybe we need to look at putting some money on that line item.
We don't do background checks?
Or? We do background checks, but people have to pay.
They have to pay for them now. Okay.
What,
okay.
We do this for
70-something.
Everybody who comes in the organization, or just, okay?
No, we have to do it.
Because none of us have had a background check.
Yes, we did.
For what I did.
As board
I was
going to
say, I had a background check.
I had them as a parent. For volunteer,
but
for
as a board member,
but you had a background check to be a board member too.
Check as a board member.
I don't remember.
Yeah,
well, I'm sure
we did.
That's
a good question.
I went to the sheriff's office.
I don't know why, because we went to the sheriff's office and had it done.
Would that be appropriate in the handbook for the board?
I had it done.
I don't know. That's a good question.
We can look it up. I just don't know that we are.
But we do. We have to have everybody has to go through a background check. It's part of Mr. Farley's our onboarding process.
I mean, it was 5 years ago, but I don't remember.
Because I had just had one, and they said I had to have another one.
New employees pay their own costs.
I had one for something else.
I filled out paperwork, but I don't think I went to the sheriff's office.
It used to be $50.
We charged. Been
our cost was $62.
I never got
fingerprinted. Moved it up to $62.
Call them and tell them.
I think I had.
Yeah, don't tell them the several crimes I committed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
she's a good child. The good child.
All right, I'm sorry. Can we get back to you?
Yeah, sorry.
Blood bank. That was something that under
went somewhere.
The American.
ACA,
yes. I'm just trying to think what it stood for. But under ACA, blood banks are no longer allowed to charge a fee to belong to a blood bank.
Oh, okay.
So that's why we took that out. And then insurance football, we have been paying an additional premium for football coverage and found out that we were actually covered under our MABE insurance pool, so there was really no need doing that, so we discontinued that.
Oh my God, how many years did we do that?
A lot of years.
At $25,000, how many years did we do that?
So,
wow.
That's essentially where we are. That's the entire operating unrestricted side of the budget, and you can see where we stand, what we have spent. I hope that this was helpful to you to understand what's in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
I open it up for questions or Let them give us our priority, their priorities.
Question. I know it's real current because I just read it in the paper in the district. But the, Governor Hogan has pushed some money to the schools. And I know that budget hasn't been passed. That's the budget he put forward to the House.
Six, I think, as a matter of fact, $6.4 million.
Right, and is it attached some of this retirement?
That's what I just asked Robin about. Yeah, okay. Since I saw that budget, when does that actually filter down to?
Because I thought there was some talk of us giving some relief on that retirement transfer, retirement money.
Yes.
Yes, there was talk of that, and at this point, I don't know what exactly it has been funded in the budget, and because of the way the state funding formula works, it depends on enrollment, and if enrollment has spiked in other counties, that actually could affect how our county is funded. So we just really have to wait. And it's usually after the government or after the governor announces his budget, it's usually within a couple weeks that we have projections from MSD as to what our budget allocations are going to look like. So,
okay. Of course, that has to get passed by the
Right.
Alrighty.
So we're at around 6 minutes, and really probably the next step, as you can see, we believe there's some areas in here that we can cost save. But one of the things that we will, I'll certainly seek some guidance from our board as to prioritizing, and probably leave that with some reflection today to give us some direction on where you think should be our highest priorities going into FY18. And then as we move into this process, the next piece is that we'll begin to start sharing with you the requests that we've gotten from schools. We believe some of those requests from schools we can do from within this budget. So we are going to go back on our end and go back on some of these items that we believe need to be looked at more closely to look at where their savings could be, and then move that into kind of the bottom line of areas that we don't believe will impact our bottom line service to children, which is our first priority. And then we can talk about the board's kind of to Mr. Farley's compensation philosophy, but I know compensation to employees is always at the top of the list, but I'll certainly seek your guidance as we move forward and in preparing the FY18 budget. Are there any questions or comments or things you want us to think about? You've given us certainly some insight as we went through these items, but is there anything that you would like us to be looking at as we go through the next phase of this process?
So we're going to discuss priorities next week.
Yeah, we've only got 5 minutes. We were really trying to plan that out kind of today, but really thought by looking at all these numbers, and since we're out of this time, is maybe just do, you know, some self-reflection, and we can start with right off the bat the next time that we meet to go into priorities. And we'll share some additional, probably that will be a good time to share the school requests mm-hmm. with you so you can see what we've seen from schools. And then we might not need in the budget workshop the entire time, but maybe a portion of that at your.
Have we had any movement yet talking to the, for the salary discussion, compensation, associations,
I know that they say they're committed to it. They've had some family things come up, and we're hoping to get back to our discussion within the next week or so. But, you know, I think we all want the same thing, which is to get to an agreement and work together to get it fulfilled.
And then we'll share with you the next time the Robin had prepared a chart on compensation of folks that are in each category. So you'll get those numbers, you know, what would it cost for 1%? What would it cost for a step at 1%? Would just 1% be? So you are have all that information at your disposal for your decision making.
Okay. That has to come back after we know what the budget is that you're proposing, right? Or you want us to tell you Because we don't know what all of this is going to shake out.
Correct. Too. But I also think it's important that if we say one step and 1%, what is that number?
Mm-hmm.
That might be helpful to know what that number is. So as we, you know, what is 1%? I think that's important information to know going in, just like this, just as a frame of reference. But you're exactly right, Captain Kelly. As we get into it, but at least you'll know if you were to direct us, you know, for a step and 1% for all employees.
So for instance, Captain Kelly, if that's what we had, and we knew we wanted to make some salary adjustments due to the market comparisons for support employees, or we wanted to adjust some stipends for additional duties, how would that factor overall into the compensation that's available?
Alrighty, well, we thank you for all your presentations. And at this time, we need a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any questions or comments? Hearing none, we'll move for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. The meeting is adjourned.